news tonight. Sources telling CNN that U.S. investigators believe Russian hackers are behind a false news report that prompted six Arab Gulf nations to cut ties with Qatar, a key U.S. ally. But in a controversial tweet, President Trump appeared to take credit for the diplomatic crisis. We're back with the New York Times columnist Thom Friedman. Speaking of tweets, yesterday the president was tweeting that the Justice Department made a major mistake in their revised travel ban. He liked the original travel ban. And today the White House is refusing to say whether or not the president even has confidence in the Attorney General Jeff Sessions. We've covered Washington for a long time. You remember anything like this?
Well, this is unprecedented, obviously. Well, first of all, we have a president who's got the sign on his desk, the buck stops everywhere but here. So he's never responsible for anything, number one. Number two, I think the implications of this, well, forget the Sessions-Trump relationship. They haven't filled out how many positions in this government? Literally hundreds, and senior ones. Deputy secretaries, assistant secretaries.
Ambassadors.
Yeah. Imagine how many people are going to want to work in a government where the president will literally turn on you on a moment's notice on Twitter, someone as close as Jeff Sessions was to this guy, probably his most loyal supporter during the campaign. Or the administration calls and said, we'd like you to join the administration, Wolf, and you go home and you tell your kids, I'm about to join an administration that believes that climate change is a hoax. What do you think, kids? Should I do that? So, I would say it was bad enough before all of this, but when Trump starts going after Sessions, someone that close, the message is nobody is safe, and I think that will be create a pall inside the administration, but I don't see how they're going to fill this ship up with anyone of competence who would want to expose themselves to that kind of thing.
You're just back in Washington from a trip to Asia. You were in China, South Korea. What's the reaction you were hearing to President Trump over there?
Well, they're utterly, flummoxed, but they're watching all of this too. But, the overwhelming reaction I had being in China, Wolf, is China's moving ahead. They're not spending their days doing this kind of nonsense and trying to figure out whether their leader tweeted something, in Chinese characters that made no sense. They're laying down more high-speed rail around the country. The amazing thing being in China, they have moved to a completely cashless society. You can buy vegetables on the street from a seller with your cell phone and his cell phone. In other words, they're really forging ahead in the 21st century. And we're basically, we've got a leader who's denying science and issuing tweets on the basis of the Drudge Report.
Do they have confidence that President Trump could handle a crisis with North Korea?
Oh, what the Chinese have confidence in?
The Chinese, South Koreans?
I think what the Chinese have confidence in is after Trump came in and scared them on trade and he's going to do all this, I think they have his number. I think they think he's a chump. And I think they know or believe they can easily deflect him with shiny objects. And that he'll never bring down that trade hammer on him that he threatened to do.
How serious is that North Korean crisis right now from their vantage point? Because, as you know, the president says China could resolve it if they wanted to. They've got the leverage on the North Koreans and Kim Jong-un.
Well, Wolf, I arrived in Korea the night before, and then I woke up the next morning, and missile tests took place that morning. Stock market was unaffected. People went to work. They've gotten totally used to it. There's a real asymmetry in the South Korean reaction, which is we're kind of used to this. I interviewed a bunch of young kids. They've learned to live with this threat. And the American reaction, which is, my God, these guys might threaten us with a missile one day. And that's going to be a huge problem between us and this new Korean government, which is even more dovish toward North Korea than the one that was unseated.
You wrote a pretty powerful column the other day in which you referred to President Trump as the Emir of the United American Emirate. Tell our viewers what you were driving at.
Well, we've actually started to resemble one of these Gulf states. We have a president who's, I think, equivalent of an emir. We have a crown prince. His name is Jared. We have a crown princess. Her name is Ivanka. We have a family that doesn't draw sharp lines between its own wealth and the wealth of the government. We have relatives who play off the notoriety and their connections with the regime. This is not the kind of government we've ever seen before, where the president's son-in-law and daughter are two of the key advisors in the government. And it's not the America we've known, Wolf. Sorry.
So where do we go from here?
I don't know, but I think we're heading to a very bad place. We have a president who, as I said earlier, does not behave not only presidential, he doesn't behave as an adult. He behaves in a juvenile way. And Wolf, stock market's high. We haven't had a crisis yet. God forbid something really big happens. I'm not certainly not looking forward to it. I hope it doesn't. But this man has behaved in such an erratic way. When the sky is blue and the market is up, I truly fear how he'd behave in a crisis.
The bottom line being?
Bottom line is I don't think he's a stable person. I'm not a doctor, but this kind of behavior, attacking people around you, how in a crisis are these people going to behave as a coherent team when every decision they make, they have to worry that the next day their boss is going to tweet against them?